Then you have Paula Hawkins, where's $1 million? One day, one city.
That's the state where you can find it, too.
You're happy about radio bounty down there.
Oh, of course, man.
We don't even mention it.
We sat next to each other. Do you remember that? It was before the campaign even got underway.
And I remember it because the several speakers before that, one by one, I'm crossing off lines in my remarks. Finally, I'm down to the one fiesta resistance that I was saving, and that was John.
India and China, 40% of the world's population, both their leaders understand full well and are anxious to renovate their antiquated industrial plant. They have to give jobs and bring their countries along. On our side, we have a great chance with both of them, Mr. President, because they instinctively like to do business with us. Our problems are twofold. Taking advantage of that tremendous opportunity. One is on technology transfer. The amount and level of technology that we will send. We've got that straightened out with China. With India, we're just signing an MOU that we think provides adequate safeguards. If we don't speed up on the technology transfer to India, it takes 6 months now to get something approved. We want to bring that down to 1 month. We can do that if we have defense on board, like they came on board with China, so we need to do that. I think it's well worth doing for us because India is a non-communist nation. It means that our COCOM partners can send stuff to them without an export license. In our MOU, they have to give us an export license, assuring us that it's going to be used for the right purpose. That's one problem. We can whip that. Second problem is adequate.
It's pleased to see you. Have you met Mr. Reagan?
No,
Mr. President.
How's
it? Mr.
President.
How do you do?
How
are you?
Good morning, everyone.
Sit down.
Yes, thank you. You're well, you're an example to us young men.
Well, it's very good. Good at last in person and not through the printed page and the letter.
Right. Well, I know the time is short, so I'd like to make a couple of specific proposals, which I've taken the liberty of putting in memo form, but a single page each, no more. And if we have time, a couple of other ones I'd like to mention. But one problem that's been exercising me for quite a long time is what I call equivalence between Soviet representation in the US and other Western countries and the other way around. Now there's obviously an imbalance. There's no uniformity of policy as between the Western allies, either on the principle of representation or on the principle of expulsions. Now, once is an exception to the rule, but for once I think that the Brits are ahead of the Yanks. And that is, when the Heath administration expelled 105 KGB and GRU men in 1971, 14 years ago, a fundamental decision was taken. If anybody at any time is uncovered as a KGB or GRU agent, that man is not replaced. Now, the other day, for example, 2 months ago, we expelled 4 Soviets. At that time, the permitted level was 43, it's now 39. And each time that happens, it goes down.
Uh-huh.
Now, I don't think you have that principle. I'm not aware that any other Western country has. If you look at the strictly diplomatic or intended to be the diplomatic representation. There's a slight imbalance, but it's not.
Step over the desk.
Mr. and Mrs. Todd, his parents?
They do that up there because he's just starting.
Forward to visiting your presidential library.
hands are usually.
Yeah, right. Yeah. Sure, we live in St. Thomas, you know. Right. He went to CSM college, but he worked with him in Stanford on a talking wheelchair.
This is a tie bar. Thank you.